Where is the home for the animals that are slaughtered to feed debaters at tournaments? Where is the home for the cows who have their milk stolen from them when their children are robbed from them at birth and held in chains to make veal? Where is the idyllic farm of the old McDonald's and humane meat down in Chicago where animals have been slaughtered en masse since its first large-scale slaughterhouse opened in 1827, not in Angola, where black prisoners are forced to raise and kill non-human inmates and are slaughtered alongside of people on death row who are imprisoned for life? Not in Newark, where at Rutgers University, animals are tortured and experimented on in the name of science that produces results only for white and wealthy who can afford it while furthering the gap between haves and have-nots. Not in zoos, where animals are held in captivity supposedly for their own good. The very same zoos that were used to house Africans and pygmies in the name of preservation. There is no longer a wilderness, a home, a place for non-human animals to return to. The oceans, the forests, the plains have all been destroyed. There is no home to return to. There is only alienation, disposition, and death wherever they turn. Thus, we agree with the affirmative that we must work to make or rather remake the continuing making of home and creatively reimagine the history, lives, and cultures of beings that will constitute a home. And we agree with the affirmative that the pedagogical work of mothering is exactly where the narrative will either be reproduced or interrupted. However, we think the affirmative pedagogical work works and reproduces the three traditional species that transmit knowledge that they seem to interrupt. We isolate three major reasons for their shortcomings that are apparent in the one performance. First, the valorizing the image of Yemaya, which in African tradition comes from the contraction of the words of Yemoja, which was whose mother who are like mother whose children are like fish. This represents the vastness of her motherhood, her vicinity and reign over all things. Upholding this deity maintains a sickly human form relationship where we must be a single ruler that reigns over all living things. It is no mistake that the depiction of Yemaya is of a human woman who acts as steward over the water and non-human creatures that dwell within the rivers and oceans. Not only are non-human animals there for the use and abuse of humans are also portrayed as the mythology as like fish, deserving of a home protection because they are paradoxically human and fish-like, while the fish themselves are alive only and responsible for sustaining conception of humans. As feminist philosopher Paola Calabari writes, the particular feature at best can be explained by reference as feminist philosopher Carol Adams' notion of the absent reference, the notion of reversal, paradoxical use of language in which something is both present and absent. The absent refers and enters into play with little treatment of an individual or group and is obscured when it is used as a metaphor or treatment of another individual group. For example, when a rape woman says that she feels like a piece of meat, the absent reference are humans, since their experience of being killed. I mean, now describes life experience of a human being raped. Now, one describes situations in which some humans, depending on historical periods and the specific institutions which they are involved in, asylums, prisons, are prisons, killed, disciplined by training or beating. More often than not, they compare their condition to that of animals, while at the same time nowhere showing any interest in condition of the treatment of animals per se. Moreover, though interpreting and employing animality as a constructed and variable category, nowhere do they attempt to deconstructing it thoroughly, forgetting the normative tendency to start from the oppressed, which merely appropriates their condition merely as a metaphor and uses parallel condition to human beings. Second, the affirmative's attempt to rework home upholds human-centered notions such as self-determination that preserve the core values of human supremacy. So this Ann Paul Taylor writes, such uniquely human characteristics as rational thought, ascended creativity, autonomy, self-determination, and moral freedom might be held to have a higher value than capacities found in other species, yet we might ask valuable to whom and on what grounds? The human characteristics mentioned are all valuable to humans. Clearly, it is not from a human standpoint that they were being judged to be desired as good. It is not here from recognizing and begging the question. Humans are claiming human superiority from a strictly human point of view. That is a point of view which humans are in the good of humans is taking the standard point of judgment. All we need to do is the capacities of non-human animals from the standpoint of to find a good contrary judgment to the superiority and for all other abilities of non-humans which further their good but which are lacking in humans. And in the case of human superiority being rejected from a non-human standpoint. Third, their focus on human racial sexual gender identities is not a neutral act, but rather explicitly works to silence the concerns and plights of non-human animals in order to make it impossible to theorize the speciesism that grounds oppression. Anne Bell and Constance Russell write, the exploration of questions of race, gender, and class sexuality have proceeded so far with acknowledgement of the systematic links between human oppressions and the domination of nature. The more than human world, the human relationships have been ignored, and the suffering and exploitation of other beings in the global ecological crisis were somehow irrelevant, despite the call for attention to voices historically absent from the traditional canons and narratives. The non-human beings are shrouded within silence. This silence characterizes even the work of writers who are rethinking all culturally positioned essentialisms. That this anthropocentric bias and critical pedagogy manifests itself in the silence and inside the text is not a topic of discussion. It can be difficult to situate the critique of animals are doomed to passively accept the given lies that they're totally determined because their decisions don't belong not to themselves but to their species. Humans are thus cast as active agents whose very essence is to transform the world. The human animal opposition upon which it rests is taken upon granted its cultural and historical specificity as not only acknowledged knowledge, and this becomes a normal way of seeing the world. Like other discourses, normalcy is limits possibilities of taking up and confronting inequities. The primacy of human enterprise is simply not questioned. These shortcomings that the one you see are not merely independent. This as rather turns the very foundation of their argument, because until we address how speciesism interlinked with other forms of oppression, will be in charge to challenge racism, sexism, homophobia, any other form of oppression found within the human condition. To this end, critical race feminist vegetarian theorist Marjorie Spiegel explains both humans and animals share the ability to suffer from restricted freedom, the government from the loss of freedom, the experience to lose a loved one. Both groups suffer and suffer from the common capacity to be terrified by hunted, tormented, or injured. Both have been objectified, treated as property rather than as feeling self-directed individuals. As and both blacks under system enslaving animals were driven to the state of psychic and physical defeat. As a result, from the rival mentioned above, from all this, we see the liberation of animals, while a pressing worthy goal within its own right, not only to import to non-human animals, their people are no longer branded, inspected, and auctioned, or displayed in zoos and subtle forms of oppression that are still in operation within counterparts in animal slavery. Advancing towards releasing animals from our domination and control of our lives will also serve a lesson to the oppression of blacks and other people who suffer under the weight of someone else's power. By eliminating the oppression of animals from the fabric of our culture, we begin to undermine some of the psychological structures inherent in the society, which seems to create and foster masters with a philosophy of universal respect to others' lives. Treating anyone as a human, non-human, in a cruel manner begins to be unthinkable. Carrie Wolf echoes his sentiment, explaining how we must stop taking the questions of species for granted. He writes, the effective power of discourse of species when prior to social others or whatever others relies to prior taking a granted institution of speciesism, that is the ethical response of acceptability and systematic non-criminal putting to death of animals based solely upon their species. We all and non-human alike have a stake in the discourse of institutional species, and may by no means limits by overwhelmingly direct disproportionate effects on animals. The great doctrines that animals in the ethical universe played history false because the identity was disengaged in terms of who was and who was not human. That's why all these prophets' justification of slavery, as well as the justification of Christianization, seem to be all right, because all these people have not graduated to humanhood. As if in Toni Morrison's arguments, in the hallmarks of individuals' imagination, the founding of the United States culture are all made possible by and shaped by active and complex awareness and employment in the institute of Africanism, which in terms the material condition and possibility of the white man's absolute power over the lives of in fact of slavery. As long as this humanist species structure of subjectification remains intact, as long as it's institutionally taken for granted that it's all the right to systematically swear and kill non-human animals simply because of their species, then the human discourse of species will always be available by use of some humans against other humans, as well as the constant of violence against other social whatever species or gender, race, or class, sexual difference. The human discourse of species not only makes it possible to the systematic killing of billions of animals every year for food processing and research, but also provides a ready-made symbolic economy that overdetermines representations of women by transcoding edible bodies and animals that the sexualized bodies of women, an overarching logic of domination. Therefore, in collaboration with the affirmative, we propose a methodology of queering that is the non-human. Michael O'Rourke writes to be shattered in our being of the world, the facilitator of the creation of the world, redesigning and makes our own space and new relations, the effective ones between the subject and the world and the world and the world's objects, clearing the non-human shadows of most conceived notions that constitutes as human in the first place. Thinking begins with non-other humans, reframing the traditional forms of humanism to make way for becoming human, and humanity is harmonization, clearing the non-human, new kind of process of ontology, transmitting the transmissions of the ailments towards one another and all others, bring upon new modes of sociability. This allows for effective relations, a community constituted through a posthumous performativity by evoking a community. Here I am drawing upon the sense of coming to community by George O'Connor, and an operative community, an anti-subjectless community of people emerging with new ethics and politics of being a singularity of relation with one another. Such an ethical political depends upon a process which is not a preconceived theological program covering the non-human designed to mean to an end but without an end.
I started it.
Okay, who is a human?
Well, when we talk about humans, we're talking about like literally like biological human beings, Homo sapiens. We're all humans.
What's
in this
a biological human?
Somebody who is defined as Homo sapiens.
Can you tell me what are some essential characteristics of being a biological human?
I mean, we stand up upright. Well, go ahead.
Yeah, our evidence directly problematizes the ability to define what human is, and it indicates the way that biology has been utilized to label what is human and what is not human.
The reason we ask this question is because in the speech you say that Yamaya is definitely a human woman. What makes you characterize her as such?
No, we don't say that she is a human being. Our argument is that within all articulations of Yamaya, she's depicted as a human being.
And what are the characteristics of that?
Well, I mean, there's some people who understand Yamaya as like a white woman who was ocean. There's some people who understand
the
original depictions
of
Yamaya are a black woman.
What are the characteristics of biological humanity that you problematize?
Just the whole category of humanity.
Okay.
All right,
cool. What's the source for your origins of like Yamaya's name and the description of Yamaya? Can you give me the source for that?
Hold on. I'm not really sure.
Are you about to?
It is Wikipedia.
Okay, thank you. What is transmisogynoir? Joe, can you answer this? Not Miguel, thank you.
Sure.
Yeah, my understanding of transmisogynoir is the way in which both queerness, race, gender, and sexuality is constructed in a way that is staticized, that needs to then be undermined.
Okay, so who experiences trans misogyny?
People who inhabit that location.
What location? Tell me the location, because I don't think you know what it means, honestly.
I think that the location is something that cannot be made as a static point that can be defined in any given speech or in any given, like, cross-examination.
Really? Okay, cool.
And part of our queering the lesbian alternative,
perfect.
Yes, ask that.
Perfect. Okay. What does the alternative look like? What does the world look like if the judge votes negative?
Well, it's a question of queering, so it's we're moving towards not having this category of humanity in the first place. That's it's an affirmation.
How do I take this back to somebody in the projects across the street?
I mean, well, there's multiple things. One of the things that we do talk about and will talk about is that's integral to this whole concept of mothering in the first place is something like nutrition, how to feed your child. It's part of how to mother your child, like things like diet, being a vegetarian, not eating meat. Is integral to mothering.
Gotcha.
I mean, I don't know. I think it is. I mean, do people not eat? They're eating right now. Everybody's eating.
Oh,
my
God. Do you have anything else?
No. I'm good. All right, we're good. I sent you the cards already. Overview and K.